now your next speaker at LibertyCon Europe, Yaron Brook. Yaron Brook is the host of the nationally syndicated Yaron Brook Show and renowned best-selling author. Brook's Radical Capitalist series can be heard weekly on the Blaze Radio, and his Living Objectivism series can be heard on the Yaron Brook Show at Blog Talk Radio and YouTube. Brook was the executive director of the Ayn Rand Institute for 17 years, from 2000 to 2017. He remains chairman of the board of ARI and its primary spokesman. Brook, an internationally sought speaker, travels extensively promoting Ayn Rand and her philosophy, objectivism, capitalism, political, and economic freedom. Please put your hands together and welcome Yaron Brook.
Belgrade. It's going to be back at, oh my God, I can't see anything. Is anybody out there? Now don't fall asleep on me, because usually I can tell, and I start yelling and it wakes you up, but I can't see anybody or anything. All right, this is not good. Okay. Anybody see the video of me being shut down by Antifa at King's College yesterday? Boo is great. 13 minutes into a talk I was given with Saga Akkad, Antifa storms in, dressed in black, storms onto the stage, and shuts it down. Now, fortunately, this is becoming more and more prevalent. This is something that's happening more and more at American universities, and I guess now at European universities, at least in the UK. The idea of free speech, the idea that we have a right to express ourselves, to talk, to be controversial, to say things that might offend people, to say things that might be unusual, that might be out of the ordinary. The idea that that is a right, the idea that that is a freedom that must be protected, that idea is disappearing from Western countries. Now, to some extent, here in Europe, we've never really embraced this idea. Do you guys hear an echo?
Yes.
Does it bug you?
No.
Does it bug you? Okay, I'll suffer through it. To some extent, in Europe, we've never really believed in free speech. I mean, at least not in the modern era. After World War II, what was the first restriction on free speech in Europe? Well, it was banning Holocaust denial. It was the idea that Holocaust denial was so offensive, so ugly, so disgusting, that nobody should be allowed to do it. That they should be sentenced to jail. Now, you can kind of understand. Can we lower the volume? Anybody? Lower the volume. One, two, three. Lower it, lower it. I don't even need a mic in this place. All right. You know, it's still there. I don't know if anybody's listening. I mean, you are, I know, but I don't know if anybody's listening to lowering the volume. So the idea is clearly offensive, the idea is clearly false, the idea is clearly disgusting, the idea of denying the existence of a Holocaust is truly stupid, evil, horrible, horrific. So, in Germany, and then in the rest of Europe, it's been banned. You can now go to jail for reading a book, or for writing an article, or for speaking, and denying the Holocaust. So, once you accept that, once you accept the breach in the idea, that it's a good idea, that free speech should be allowed, then there's no limit. And if denying Holocaust is offensive, what about saying certain things about certain other groups? What about denying anything in history? What about denying any facts? And what you're seeing in Europe is that slippery slope that people say doesn't exist. but indeed always exists. That once you violate a right, once you give an exception, once you use force to silence people, even if those people are truly disgusting, then that use of force to silence people is going to expand and expand and expand to any idea that offends somebody out there. So not only did Antifa shut down our event at King's College a few weeks ago, but King College has announced since then that they are having no more controversial, in quote, events on campus this semester because they don't want to offend, I guess, the students. They don't want to offend those who show up. So they even canceled an event by a King's College professor who was going to give a talk about free speech. It was canceled at King's College. Once you accept that silencing people is okay, freedom is finished. Free speech is maybe the most important right we have that we must fight for, because without it, no other rights will exist. Why is it? Why is free speech so crucial, so important? Why is it, in many respects, the basis for everything else that we want to do? Because at the end of the day, we're here to try to change the world. And how are we going to change the world? Anybody up for a violent revolution? I'm afraid to ask. Yes. Where do we go? Where's the answer? Logic in order to do it. We're going to have to convince people. We're going to have to argue and debate and discuss with people. And our ideas are out of the mainstream. Our ideas are controversial. Our ideas offend some people. Socialists are very offended by my talks. Anybody who's a collective, anybody who's a state, is offended by ideas. Literally, emotionally, they are distressed when they leave one of my lectures. Changing, of debating, of discussing. We lose our weapon in the battle for ideas, which is the ability to speak, to write, to do videos, to present alternative ideas into the culture. If you really want to change the world, if you really have a vision for a world that is different, that is freer for the individual, then there's no right more important to defend right now, today, given the attacks on it in the US and starting now in Europe, than the what been and free speech. This is the most important challenge of our time. If we are silenced, we lose. They already dominate the universities. They already dominate the discussion. They already dominate the media, the status do. We are the ones who are challenging all that. We are the ones who will be silenced first. So, if you're going to dedicate yourself to this battle for liberty, for this battle for capitalism, for the battle for freedom, then I think first and foremost, right now, the most urgent issue is this issue of free speech. It's not just that we need to be able to speak, to project our ideas. What does speech represent? What is it that, what is an attack on speech really represent? It represents fundamentally an attack on the human mind. It represents fundamentally an attack on human thinking, on reason, on our ability to think. Think outside the box. Think new ideas. Think in an unconventional way. Because expression is an expression of what? Of a thought. If we are banned from speaking, we are ultimately banned from thinking. Think about Galileo and Pythagoras, right? He's just made the discovery and announced to the world the radical idea that the Earth goes around the Sun, not the Sun around the Earth. And this is offensive. It's offensive to the Catholic Church, to the authority, to the people in power. So what did they do here? They put him in house arrest. See, he's in house arrest. Do you think in a house arrest Galileo is thinking of new discoveries, is doing new science, is testing the boundaries of human knowledge? No, that's the motivation. He can never write it down. He can never express it. He can't go out into the world and advocate for it. He is shut down. Force, coercion, authority shuts down the mind. It shuts down reason. It shuts down thinking. It shuts down the tool that is uniquely human, the tool that we human beings need in order to survive and in order to thrive. Reason is what makes it possible for us to live. What makes it possible for us to innovate. Makes it possible for us to thrive and to flourish as human beings. By shutting down speech, we shut down this tool. By shutting down this tool, we shut down human progress and human success. So again, nothing more important than fighting for the idea of free speech, the idea that we should be able to say anything, anything, as offensive as it might be, on our own property, on our own time, on our own stage, we have that right. Now note these days that the right in America is demanding not just to be able to speak from their own stage, but is demanding to force people who own stages to let them speak on those stages. Think about what's going on with YouTube and Twitter and the social media. A lot of people are very upset by the fact that YouTube and Facebook and Twitter are taking stuff off, are demonetizing content. They demonetize my content all the time. Anytime there's something in the title that has foreign policy or sex or anything that they deem controversial, which is a lot of stuff, right? They demonetize it, so I can't make any money on it. And people are upset, and I'm upset, you know? My content is, it's kind of radical. But, you know, I'm not so dangerous. Well, maybe I am. But they're demonetizing it, and people are upset. But some people, I don't know if you know Dennis Prager in the United States, is actually suing YouTube to demand that they monetize his content. Monetization means there's ads in the content. In other words, he's saying, you and your private business have to have my content. Now, is that freedom of speech? What does freedom of speech actually relate to? It relates to government action, not to private action. Freedom of speech is the right not to be silenced on your stage. It doesn't mean every radio station has to give you a microphone, that every TV station has to interview you, that every internet platform has to carry your video. It means that the government cannot use force against you to silence you, or that if you have a stage, the government should be protecting you from thugs and brutes like Antifa. But it does not give you the right to use force against a YouTube or a Facebook, demand their microphone, demand their platform. I mean, YouTube tomorrow can decide, we don't like Libertarians, we're taking you all off. We don't like Objectivists, we're taking you all off the platform. It's their platform. I have a right, I should have a right, on my business. Right? When I run an Objectivist conference, only Objectivists speak at the conference. Or at least I decide who speaks and who doesn't. It's not an open platform that everybody can speak on. So the danger with not understanding properly free speech is that we err on the side of suspecting everybody to give us a platform. No, if people won't give us a platform, we need to create our own. We need to find ways to create those platforms. But it is not your right to force somebody else to put your content on. There seems to be a lot of confusion, particularly among conservatives, about this issue. There's a huge movement in the US today among conservatives to regulate Facebook and Twitter and YouTube and to force them to include so-called conservative content on with everything else. So it's important that if we fight for something, we know what we're fighting for. We're fighting against the use of force in silencing us. The prevention of us using our own private property to convey ideas. If we use force against others by suing YouTube, we acknowledge that the use of force is okay. We acknowledge that force, that violence, that coercion is fine. Because that's what Prager is trying to do. Use the state to force YouTube to accept his content. YouTube should be free to do whatever the hell they want. It's their business, not ours. You want a YouTube? Start one. You want a platform? Create one and build one for yourself. Invite whoever you want onto that platform. Now, in order to fight against free speech, so we need to understand what it is. And we need to understand what the positive is. And as I said, the positive is ability to think, ability to reason, ability to act freely in the world, think freely and act based on those thoughts. Speech is just one manifestation of that act. But the idea that each one of us has the capacity to reason, that each one of us has the capacity to think for oneself, to live for oneself, to take care of oneself, is really at the heart of the idea of liberty, at the heart of the idea of political freedom. It's no accident that political liberty comes out of the Enlightenment, that the idea of freedom is a product of the age of, what's another name for the Enlightenment? Age of
reason.
It is the recognition that truth does not come from revelation. The truth is not the purview of the philosopher kings. The truth is accessible to every single individual. The thinking is possible for every individual. The reason is possible for every individual. And therefore, every individual can take care of himself. When Newton presents his laws of physics to the world, relation between Newton and liberty. When Newton presents his ideas of physics to the world, people suddenly realize that, hey, we can understand the way objects move based on simple logical laws, on principles that are available to every human being. We can all understand Newton's physics. If you didn't do physics class, it was because you had a bad teacher. They're not that hard. Wow. Each one of us has the capacity to do that. Before, we were told that in order to understand how anything works in the world, we have to access some ancient book, or we have to have some kind of way in which to get truth from the world of spirits. But no, it turns out that we all have the capacity to know the real world. And if we have the capacity to know the real world in physics, then wow, maybe I can make decisions for myself about what profession I should have, who I get to marry, who should govern me, how I should live my life. This tool I have, this reasoning tool, is a tool that makes everything possible for me as an individual to live my life. I'm not dependent on authorities. I'm not dependent on the philosopher kings. I can live my life for myself. I can make decisions for myself. It's not an accident that that leads to rebellion against authoritarianism. that leads to a rebellion against kind of the oppressive state, and ultimately leads to the Declaration of Independence and to everything that comes out of the Enlightenment. An individualism, a focus on the individual, and the idea of individual liberty and individual freedom. So reason, the idea that we all have reason, the idea that we should all be able to express ourselves, is core to the idea of political freedom. The fact is that we all truly do live in Plato's cave. We all truly do not know what's out there, what reality is like. If none of us have access to the truth, if only philosophers kings have access to the truth, then we need them. We need them to tell us how to live, what values to pursue, who should be our leaders, political leaders. We need authorities. So it's this choice between reason and other, spiritual, if you will, means of knowledge, which is at the core of liberty. The idea that we all possess reason, that we don't depend on authorities, that we don't depend on others for the truth. And of course, the thinkers of the ancient Enlightenment knew very well that ideas and sight we have to be expressed, and that they must have the freedom to express those ideas. They were all under attack, whether it was John Locke who was afraid of a Catholic king, or Voltaire who was afraid of the religionists in France at the time and had to escape Paris. They all realized that you have to be able to express ideas, even ideas that are offensive. And at the end of the day, all truth is offensive, right? All truth is offensive to somebody who held another belief before. I'm sure we know people were offended by Galileo. I bet you people were offended by Newton. People are offended by anything that's new and anything that's true. And if we accept offense, hurt feelings, as the standard of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable, there is no free market, right? Even in economics, do people get offended by new stuff? Like taxi drivers, are they offended by Uber? Yeah. Everything new is offensive to somebody. Everything new destroys something. Right? Schumacher called it creative destruction. There's always somebody who's being laid off. There's always somebody who's shutting down. There's always somebody going bankrupt. And they're offended. Why should the newest time out? If we accept offense as the standard of right, if we accept offense as the standard by which we are okay to use force, not only is speech gone, but all liberty is gone, and all freedom is gone. Indeed, if we accept emotion as the standard for truth, as the standard by which we should behave, then liberty and freedom and dialogue and discussion and logic are all out the door. Reason, emotions are great. I have pretty emotional life. But emotions are not tools of cognition. We don't know what is true or what is not based on emotions. We know something about ourselves, but it doesn't tell us about the world out there. And when people are taught, as I think they are today, now schools in America, I think it's a little better in Europe, but in America, kids are put around the tables and circles and asked what they think or what they feel about everything. They're not taught. Everything is a discussion. Everything is a debate about, usually about emotions and about self-esteem. And what we're teaching our kids today is that emotions are the most important thing. Reason, don't want to trust that too much. And what happens when people think that emotions are the tools for living? What's going to be the result? Well, they're going to fail in living. And when they fail in living, they become afraid. And they become afraid, they look for people who are like them, people who can guide them, people who can help them. Fear is a very, very dangerous emotion, particularly politically. People then huddle in tribes. They huddle in groups. They see security in people who look like them, who think like them, who can reflect back to them their own fears. And what do tribes need in order to know what to do? How does a tribe know what it should do? It needs a leader. It needs a dictator. It needs an authoritarian to tell everybody what to do. Once we elevate emotions about reason, we are asking for the philosopher kings to come back. We are asking for authoritarians to lead us. We are asking for people, authorities to guide us. Once we abandon reason, we abandon individual liberty, we abandon individual freedom. Once we abandon reason, we abandon any kind of individualistic future. So in the fight for free speech, in the fight for freedom and liberty, we must fight for the idea of reason, for the idea, for the age of reason, of the efficaciousness of the human mind, of our ability as individuals to know the truth. And the fundamental idea that only the individual can know the values that are important to that individual. Only you can live for you. And one of the things that they identified in the Enlightenment is that the enemy of reason, the enemy of thought is force, coercion, authority. And if we want to live in freedom, that is what must be extracted from society. That must be eliminated from all society. And in this sense, I may be in opposition to some of you here. I believe you have to have governments. You have to have a monopoly over the use of retaliatory force. You have to have an element that extracts force from society so that we can all live free, think free, and speak free. So, think about time. 2 minutes, I was waiting for the 2 minute mark. So, I encourage everybody here, as you go back to your home countries, to stand for the ideas of freedom and liberty, and project a positive image out there, positive ideas out there, a defense of the individual, a defense of reason. Don't let anybody silence you. Use your voice. Use your voice. Speak up. Fight against Antifas and the silencers of the world out there. If we lose our voice, if we lose our ability to speak, we ultimately lose our ability to live. We ultimately will lose the future. If we are to win, we must speak, 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 and we must fight for everybody's right to speak, speak, speak. So go out there and fight for free speech. Thank you all.
And as we did yesterday, if there are questions from the audience, all you need to do is to tweet at me, and as those questions come in, I will make sure that we ask them all of our guests. Is there a mic on?
No. Is it on? See, I don't need a mic. You can give me a phone. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. There we go.
All right, so actually my first question that's coming in is for you, Yaron. And the question is, when a private company's platform like Facebook or YouTube becomes the dominant monopoly for information, do they have a responsibility to maintain access and freedom of expression for their users?
Well, first I reject the whole idea of they have a monopoly. In a marketplace, there are no barriers, real barriers to entry, particularly not in technology today. You don't know what the next innovation is going to be. We don't know what the next platform is going to be. Facebook didn't exist just a few years ago. YouTube is brand new. All these things. I mean, you guys, it's been around your entire adult life, but they didn't exist that long ago. So I reject the idea of monopolies, and
technology is still relatively a free market. It's not a pure free market, but it's relatively a free market. So innovators and entrepreneurs can replace the existing players fairly quickly, I believe, even in the marketplace, even the dominant players in this space. Do they have a responsibility? I guess, in some sense, they have a responsibility to have, to let most people publish. I can see them not wanting certain point of view on their platform. If the Islamists and the Nazis want to dominate the platform, I can see them maybe not wanting those. But at the end of the day, these are private platforms. This is private property. We believe in private property. What private property means is you get to decide who uses it and who doesn't. My private property, I get to decide who to invite to my house and who not to. They have every right to discriminate. They have every right to decide who to have on their platform and who not to have on their platform. It might not make business sense, or it might make business sense. I don't know what their calculation is financially. But at the end of the day, their obligation as CEOs of Facebook is to maximize his shareholder wealth. And if he believes that excluding my videos from his platform maximizes shareholder wealth, he has every right to do that, even if I don't like it, right? Even if I'm offended by it, then he has a right to do it. If we believe in anything, I think we believe in private property and the right of users to use that private property as they see it.
Yeah, can I just add to this? And I'm not agree with you, but it's also making clear that that doesn't mean that you can be absolutely trenchant and harsh in criticizing them and calling upon what you might think is could be a responsibility. Discussion that in Hardenberg called Capitalism concept yesterday, and users, if they stand as one responsible, we can call them out and we can make that public. And what's the purpose of this is and what this all is undermined? Of course, they have the right, and we're not a state, we shut them down. But this is when we have to be silent and not criticize.
Yeah, absolutely. So, my next question actually is this is your passion, is that the you face criticism from within your professional community in regards to your views. How do you deal with the backlash from those in your space that criticize you solely for the way you see the world?
Well, I mean, I suffer from what you almost talked about as a kind of degeneration of public debate. There's kind of taboos and very quickly people go run around and go at home and they just go and make it at you and just classify you and moral and false ways, and I think that's and this emotional charge is really getting away. And it's kind of being upset and it's kind of culture of pressing offense. I think that's really what you have to do about kind of fixing the robust and call for that. You need to move to that meta argument about discursive culture and the importance of these issues and threats. So I was under that element of yours I was talking about this morning. I mean, and I think it's very important that I did make this meta and I should do this meta level. As I think, be tolerant of Facebook. I mean, I'm asking everything. If there's a slight chance beyond being negative, there is a little bit of coming back. But oftentimes people feel mad and look at this suing back or blocking. Actually, yeah, these people become really friends because I think in the office, people are in that kind of false currency of cultural patterns. We need to combat the matter and go back to the content itself. And I think we need to, in the public debate, kind of give you some sort of credibility that we're working at the same goal of the human project, human emancipation.
Yeah, and so actually my next question can be asked for both of you. It's originally written for Patrik, but so the question is that you've spoken openly about more and more open building in a more interconnected world. What does this mean for privacy, and how much should people care about that? And we can actually have you both weigh in here in terms of the importance of privacy.
Well, I think ultimately it's great, I feel, and it has a resilience stuff if they can open up, discuss and really share ideas and get You know, and I saw one of the things which the planet regulates, and they actually make a simple thought that you can put the market in a harbor which is close to another one, or you have overlooking, so you can live up that kind of lighted, frosted windows. But maybe, you know, it's also these things that get rid of, and we need to discover in the free process what the various subcultures, which tribes should be used, and they might prefer, and then we can. But I think what I believe is this, I don't believe that everything is on the market and you can just change. I do believe in discourse, in public discourse, which is another layer. Which is the exchange, which is traumatized, which more than just influence and convince others, not the club, with the forces that are arguing. And I believe in that circle that we should share, we should try to converge. It's not like, well, everybody is own, a little bit live in a sense, it's great, the absence of force, but not in the sense of letting people kind of stew in their superstitions and self-destructive patterns. No. We should kind of help each other in this sense, be responsible for each other's idea. I think what you're talking about, these are very important, and then it empowers people. But at the same time, in isolated individuals, that's very, very little chance of any reason whatsoever, because that's always something where actually you isolate yourself, like after 3 days, you'll be almost real and hungry. So we need this continuous feedback and confirmation and jigging and communication, I think. And that's what should be not afraid. That's why I think we need to have kind of open fight the rest of the day. Just never home. I can kind of find your ideas horrendous. And I want to tell you to rid yourself of this kind of horrendous stuff, right?
And so you are, in terms of the work that you do, obviously people know your viewpoint on markets and capitalism, but maybe elaborate for us in terms of your perception on privacy questions and its importance.
I mean, my view is privacy is crucial. I think part of what makes us civilized is that we have our own space, that we own, you know, what we share and what we don't share. And if you look at some of the pictures, you know, in hunter-gatherers live in community. Everything's shared. You know, they watch each other defecate, they watch each other having sex, everything is out in the open. And I think it's certainly a civilizing process when we have private property, when we have an idea of what is ours and what is our space. And I think that you see that in architecture, you see that in the idea of single family homes, you see that in private yards. And I think it's a false dichotomy to present that opposite communication or opposite sharing information. Of course, individualism or the idea of reason is not living on a desert island. Nobody wants to live on a desert island. We need other people. We need I was at a presentation the other day and somebody said, you know, when I get up in the morning, I use all this stuff that I don't know how to make myself, right? All the equipment in my home, the electricity, everything, my iPhone, I don't know how to build those things. Of course I need other people to trade with, so I can trade my skills for their skills, so I can enlarge my space. But I think it's important, particularly in the era of Facebook and everything, that we find a legal mechanism by which we own our data, we own what the information. We can give it to other people, and contractually let them use it however they want, or not, we're restricted. But in America today, you know, the privacy is gone. Once you share your information with Facebook, the government can access it directly. Once you've given it to Facebook, the government assumes that you have no ownership over it anymore, and they can take it and use it any way they want. Now, if the government can do that, it's not surprising to me that Facebook feels like they can do it as well. So we need a new legal regime which defines our information as our own private property. And where we can then contract under certain terms to give it. You know, some people might want to share everything. And some people want to share a little bit.
Some people may just want to share pictures of their dog.
And what they ate for breakfast. And
exactly.
I
don't
necessarily
think that
being
a master of all global legal regime, the master of the legal frameworks, the institutions, the legal pluralism, and free contracting, also standards, and the gathering.
your standards, you've got some kind of uniform. The standards should be the protection of individual rights. You shouldn't have a legal regime that violates individual rights.
Okay. Reason and individuality and this idea of autonomous conditions. So, because I think if you look at science, it's really clear you only know something about yourself, not the idea of the form, but in opening up and publishing and critique and counter-critique in that dialogue and reproducibility, understanding of arguments and repression of this for access to this is what sets up knowledge against unknowledge and false knowledge. So in a sense, we're depending always already on a collective, on a cooperative process, even to understand, for instance, our own self-identity, also process practice in social relations, and the knowledge of the means and its relationships, which helps define our coping interests, cannot be originally created. So that challenges this kind of realness. Maybe the methodological division is like, so we need to understand that the social process, the knowledge of the social process, that doesn't challenge.
I mean, I don't
really care if it doesn't, but it puts a little nuance.
I don't agree with that, and I certainly don't think that's scientific. I mean, it's true that most of us produce knowledge that way, but. Newton did discover his laws of debate with other scientists. The great geniuses, certainly they stand on the giants of geniuses before them, but it's not a social interaction that produces knowledge. What produces knowledge is hard work, the use of reason and observing reality, and the genius of being able to integrate it in new creative ways. If you think of kind of the isolation, even Darwin put himself under pressure because he didn't want his idea stolen, which they kind of were. This is very much an individual. New knowledge, real genius discoveries, is an individual process, very much an individual process. And it rests on, again, the foundation of other people's knowledge. So we need that interaction. But it's not a collective endeavor in that sense.
Yeah. So the last question we'll close with, which you can both take a stab at here, is there ever an instance in your eyes, or are there instances in your eyes where for the betterment of the greater good, that argument holds sway or convinces you? Are there instances where you find that argument persuasive, is that a philosophy that just is not fit with your kind of perception of the world?
There's no such thing. What the hell is the greater good? Right? What's good for us? In kind of what value is common to in some? Where is this greater? Where is this collective better? Right? There's even in the capitalism, in under complete freedom, there's certain people that materially are better off. If you're a wife beating drunk, socialism is better for you. But it's good that you suffer, because you deserve to suffer. So under freedom, you will be worse off, and that's justice. So I don't believe in the greater good. I think utilitarianism is just an excuse to violate the rights of the minority for the sake of the majority. I think it's an oppressive moral regime that's been refuted over and over and over again. So, we're not going to try that. I believe that the only good is the individual good. Now, again, let's not think that the individual good is being on an island. It's not being on an island. The individual good is interacting with other people and creating community and trading and interacting and learning and exchanging ideas. But at the end of the day, the measure of moral good is only the individual. There is no such thing as collective good in that sense. So if you have to define what's good for the collective, it's whatever's good for the individuals within. So why even bother with the collective in that sense? Why even bother with society? Let's just talk about what's good for individuals. And what's good for individuals is the protection of their rights. What's good for individuals is the freedom to use their reason to pursue the values that they deem necessary for their thriving and flourishing. That's good. Everything else is an excuse to oppress somebody for the sake of somebody else.
The whole point of public debate is, I was showing you this week that there's an economic aspect argue in this sense that they're referring back to some kind of notion of greater good is a nearly inevitable a priori of any public debate, otherwise you want to be listened to.
Or you can say
as well. And that's implicitly, I don't feel affected that, is an a priori of this sort as well.
So all you can say is that if you leave individuals free, those who pursue the right values will do well, and those who pursue bad values will do poorly. That's what you can say. Yes, the average is better, but most of us pursue good values. Most of us pursue the values that enhance human life. So on average, we're all better off. But some people are going to screw their lives when they're free. And that's okay with me, right? So, it's about the individual's ability, again, to use their mind, and the result is, well, most of us, because most of us are going to use our minds well, are going to be better off. But to make a statement of all, or to make a statement of what makes it good is an average, well, what if I could show you as, and maybe this is the appeal of Leonard Mons, that by sacrificing some, the average goes up. Then it's okay. And I say it's never okay to sacrifice a minority for the sake of the majority. It's never okay to sacrifice an individual for the sake of the average. Individuals must be free. The beautiful result of leaving individuals free is the average goes up. Good.
So, do you?
So, look, I'm an anti-capitalist. I have no collective force.
Sure.
Zero needs to have that. Yet, I understand that I'm peeling at the problem of anti-capitalism in the name of greater good and also rejecting other positions because they turn out to be kind of greater evils. So I think that it's interesting that the way I discursively answer that way of any public discourse. But the result is non-coercive, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, on behalf of us as well, I want to thank both of you for coming. To have you both here individually and on the same stage together sharing thoughts is a real honor and a pleasure for us. So if you wouldn't mind, please give our guests